And as other speakers have spoken before me, glaucoma is a progressive disease, and we have highlighted how you have to keep progressing, to keep evaluating the patients for progression and identify the ones who are going to go down, and that is the only way you can actually prevent them from having serious visual dysfunction. So you have to assume that all patients, whether they are suspects or they are already established glaucomas, are progressing. Only that the rates of progression are different, and you want to identify the ones who are rapidly progressing towards blindness. The earliest changes, usually the structural changes, they say precede the functional changes, but this is not something which is true in all cases. So the structural may show up first, or the visual field may show up first. So you need to do both the tests in tandem on a continuous basis, and they have to be evaluated together. The most important question a lot of people ask, how frequent? Because we are having problems here in doing the first test itself, and then you have to keep repeating it. Usually more frequent tests are advised in the early part of the after the diagnosis. So in the first 2 years after your diagnosis, ideally you need up to 6 visual fields in that period of time. In case the patient has a longer learning curve or the defects are very close to fixation, more tests would be advised. Further frequency of testing would be decided on the stability and the threat to fixation as you have identified in the initial part of the course of the disease. Second point is, when you start testing, what are the tests you need to see? A lot of people do screening tests for glaucoma, and that's not the way you are going to be evaluating for progression. You need to do the visual field test. Ideally, the first test should test the 30-degree field. The later follow-up tests, especially there are no peripheral defects and mainly central, you can come down to the 24-2. The 10-2 test, which looks only at the central 10 degrees, would be extremely useful in cases where the fixation is threatened and the defects are close to fixation within the 10-degree field. And also when you see no fiber layer defects and when there are no defects or no significant defects seen in the larger field test, you can do a 10-2 and look more carefully at the center. When you are looking at progression, whether you are using the visual fields or you are using structural tests, there are two basic principles that you want to follow. The first is the event analysis, where one test which you have done is compared to the baseline which you had done in the beginning. And then you need to see the change. And the second way to look at it is to look at the trend, where all the tests parameters are plotted onto the graph and you see its progress over time. That gives you a slope, which would be the speed at which the patient is progressing. So looking at both these would be important in evaluating progression. So how do you get these? One is the manual method, where you gather all the reports, put them on a big table and start looking them manually and evaluate and see for yourself whether it's progressing. And for our purpose, for in this modern age, we have computers and softwares which can do this for you, and you can use this, but I think you should use both. Look at it manually as an overview and use the software which is available to you to guide you a little more carefully. When you are looking at the visual field, you need to see whether the defect you have identified in your initial test, is it deepening, is it expanding, or is there a new defect developing in a new area, or is there a generalized defect? So these are the four ways in which your visual field is likely to get worse. Sometimes you get this kind of a field where the baseline and the follow-up, and you don't need any software or anything to tell you that this patient has got a lot worse than the first time you saw him. But all cases are not so stark, and that is the whole key. You want to look very carefully for smaller change, and for that you require guidelines. You cannot just put two together and say, this looks a lot more black. That's not good medicine. So you need to apply certain parameters. If you have a previous defect and you think it's got deeper, the parameter you will use is see if there is a cluster of 3 points which are not on the edges, which have reduced by 10 decibels further, or a cluster of 3 non-edge points or 3 points within the same scotoma which have gone down by 5 decibels if the initial defect already was at p-value less than 5%. And this has to be repeated in consecutive fields because we know there is known fluctuations. If you are looking at an expanding field defect, you are going to look at 2 previously normal points in the central 15 degrees or 3 points if it is outside the central 15 degrees, which have declined more than 10%, 10 decibels or depressed more than p-value of 5% in, again, two consecutive fields. And if there is a previously normal area which wasn't affected earlier, and you see three non-edge points which have depressed more than 5 decibels, or a single point which has gone down by 10 decibels in two consecutive repeatable fields, you will identify this as progression. So you have an example here of three fields which have been done in a period of 2 years, and you can see that in this you have expansion of this inferior field defect as well as a new field defect appearing in the superior field. So this is a patient who definitely shows progression over this period. The software is also available in all the perimeters. There are various in this time. I will not be able to cover everything. But the Zeiss perimeter has got what we call the GPA, which is based on the EMGT, or the early manifest glaucoma trial progression criteria. It uses the pattern deviation plot, and it has been validated on a multi-center study of glaucoma patients. And you get what you know as a visual field index, which is used for the trend. Visual field index is similar to the mean deviation which you get in the previous methods. And when you do the test is going to compare the follow-ups with the baseline and give you an indication of open or non-shaded triangle, which will show that there is progression with a 95% significance. A half-shaded triangle, which says that this has been repeatable in two tests. And a fully shaded triangle, which says in three consecutive tests, at that point, the progression has been confirmed. And when you get that, you will get a written alert saying possible progression, or if it is repeated three times, it will say likely progression. This will make your life easier. And this is the kind of printout you can get, where you have seen identified points which are changing. They have been repeated once, and then when there's repeated three times, you can say that it says likely progression, and it is identified the area where it is progressed. At this stage, you can also get this kind of a printout, which will show you this is the trend of the visual field index, and it shows you a prediction over the next 5 years, what is likely to happen and how fast this patient is going to progress towards blindness. Once you have all this visual field data, it is still very important to look at the structure also. Being subjective, the visual fields are known to have fluctuations, and therefore you should be able to identify it repeatably and reliably in the same location before you confirm that this is really progression. And most important, you need to correlate this with what you see on the optic disc. This is an overview of the patient, which you can see there's a lot of fluctuation here in the kind of visual field defect, and you can assume that here there is actually some progression occurring, while if you see the last, again, it has become similar to this one. Most important, if you see the optic disc, this is the baseline optic disc, which is a tilted optic disc with a large area of peripapillary atrophy. This kind of a disc is not going to be reliable on an imaging test. You have to depend on the structural evaluation only on photographs, 3D stereo photographs, and you can see on the follow-up. And since the defect which you saw was in the superior field, you look at the inferior pole, look at this blood vessel area. Even though this is not very much in focus, but you can see that there is hardly any change occurring at the inferior pole. And that gives you an indication that whatever this initial visual field is showing some amount of progression, but probably there isn't any real progression. And you go on following up this patient to see if there is anything significant showing up. Visual field-based tests and initial blindings, you can plan what you want to look at. As I said, if you see a very central defect, you are going to plan on looking at 10-2 fields. To save the patient's time, you can repeat only 10-2 fields more frequently. And in structure also, since I said all, this is a 10-2 field which I wanted to show. In the structure also, if the discs are small in size and you are not going to be able to get reliable data, you should decide on which will be the most reliable test, whether it is a photograph or whether it is an imaging test. And in a non-standard or a large disc, you may not get very good data in the baseline, but you can use the imaging devices like the HRT, which has got very robust imaging progression software available, which also has been validated for the study in glaucoma patients. And you can get event analysis based on the topographic change analysis, which will give you the comparison of the follow-up with the baseline and will print a trend for you. This is the same patient's trend showing continuously that he is slowly progressing.
Manish,
This is another patient which also is showing some amount of progression, and this is confirmed on visual field test. So bottom line is you have to keep looking at your patient very carefully before deciding on progression. Continuously observing structure and function is very essential in all subtypes of glaucoma. Due to variations and fluctuations, determining progression can be tricky. It is useful to use statistical tools which are available to us and, most important, clinically correlate. Thank you very much.